Should Christians support the death penalty? Does God support the death penalty? And what does the Bible, both the Old and New Testaments, say about the subject? Jeffrey Dahmer raped, killed, and to some extent ate at least 13 men. The government's punishment, they were going to feed him, clothe him, educate him, medicate him, legally represent him, even entertain him for the rest of his life. Members of the victims' families, their taxes would in part go to keep Jeffrey Dahmer warm in winter and cool in summer. With punishment like that, is that going to deter future mass murderers? We have murderers like Susan Smith, who killed her two children and is now reportedly having affairs in prison. We have in the Chicago suburbs, early 1996, a woman wanted a baby. Well, she and two of her friends went to a woman who was about ready to give birth and killed that woman and ripped open her womb and literally stole her baby. We've reached a time in America where murder, mayhem, rape, it's epidemic. How do we end the crime epidemic in America? Because it is true, we put very few people to death. However, murderers are putting 24,000 people to death every year in our country. In the Old Testament, Christians universally agree that the Old Testament supports the death penalty. But many argue that when we get to the New Testament, then that's where the rules changed. And Jesus told us to turn the other cheek and forgive and to not execute criminals. We're going to investigate that to find out if that's really what occurred in this Bible. But before we get to that, let's look at a passage in the Old Testament. In Ezekiel chapter 13 and verse 19, God is slamming the false prophets in Israel. And he says in verse 19, "Will you profane me among my people? Will you profane me among my people, killing people who should not die and keeping people alive who should not live?" Wow. God says, "You're profaning me because you're killing people who should not die." That's murder. "And you are keeping people alive who should not live." Now, how are they doing that? God says, "By your lying to my people who listen to lies." Many people, hundreds if not thousands of people who in the past have heard the material you're about to hear, people who have strongly opposed the death penalty on moral and biblical grounds, have changed their minds because they've seen that there is overwhelming evidence that God supports the death penalty. In fact, that it was his idea, and he remains firm today, insisting that those who would love him and obey him would see to it that murderers and capital criminals are executed by the government. So God says, "You profane me because you're keeping people alive who should not live." But others argue that is not what God said. Well, you know, just earlier in this chapter, verse 7, God says, "You say the Lord says, but I have not spoken." And God gets angry when people misrepresent him. So this is an important question. Some oppose the death penalty on practical grounds. They argue that it's not a deterrent. However, in the late 60s, the U.S. Supreme Court prohibited the death penalty. They said that it was unconstitutional as applied, and so it was effectively banned. And at the time in this country, we had about 6,000 murders a year. And then approximately 6 years later, the death penalty was allowed again. And our murder rate had gone up from about 6,000 a year to about 16,000 a year. An incredible increase. Today, with very little execution in response to murder conviction, our death rate now is about 24,000 a year, an epidemic of murder. In fact, among young black men, murder is the number one cause of death. What a tragedy. So some people say the death penalty is not a deterrent, But if we look at a country like Saudi Arabia, where they have a swift death penalty, they have an incredibly low violent crime rate. Not only Saudi Arabia, but we could go to Singapore. Singapore, where we had an American vandal who was caned over there. 90% of Americans support caning, just as the vast majority of Americans support the death penalty. But those who control the media and our universities and many of our politicians, all of our liberal politicians, come against these forms of punishment that God has authorized. Well, we had the gall. I recall the city council in Los Angeles especially was protesting that Singapore would cane an American citizen. And Singapore and LA have similar demographics. They're about the same size population-wise. And if you compare the death rate for Los Angeles proper, with the death rate for Singapore, the murder rate, guess what? In 1 year, in early 1990s, Singapore, 58 murders. That's sad, 58 murders. Los Angeles, 1,063 murders. Wow. Over 1,000 more people dead in Los Angeles. Why? Because Los Angeles is more progressive than Singapore. They're more advanced, they're more loving, they're more merciful. We see the cost of misguided mercy, misguided forgiveness and understanding, misguided love. Love without justice is perverse. And that's what we see in our nation today, a nation of perversity. Others oppose the death penalty on moral grounds, not practical, that while it may or may not deter crime, but it's immoral, it's wrong. Now, there are two classes of people who argue against the death penalty on moral grounds. Atheists and agnostics, and then religious people, and many Christians. Right? Now, the arguments, the moral arguments of atheists are not persuasive and cannot be. Because if there is no God, we are only a product of evolution. We are just like animals. And if one fish eats another fish, it's not right or wrong, it just happens. And so if one man kills another man, it's not right or wrong. There is no right or wrong. There is no God to an atheist. Of course, the atheist is wrong, but the atheist has no moral foundation to make a moral argument. The world has gone insane when we have secular humanists arguing about the sacredness of human life. I mean, it's absolutely beyond belief. How can an atheist, a secular humanist, say human life is sacred? Right? They're more than eager to kill the unborn child, baby boys or girls, or sick old people, have them euthanized. So it seems that to the humanist, the only sacred human life is the convicted mass murderer rapist. That's the sacred life. But the innocent unborn boy or girl, or even as the boy or girl is being born, they're in the birth canal. They're mostly delivered. Their legs are kicking. They're out. And only their head remains inside the mom. Our liberals in government and in the media still support killing that baby at that last moment. Partial birth abortion or a DNX abortion. So the moral arguments of atheists and secular humanists are not persuasive. But let's look, and we will do this as we get into this analysis, this investigation. Let's look at the moral arguments of Christians, because these arguments have often intimidated good people. You quote Jesus where he says, "Forgive and turn the other cheek, and he is without sin, cast the first stone." And to Christians, those are forceful ideas because they were spoken by the Lord of the universe. Jesus Christ created all that is. And anyone who has come to him in faith and anyone who's been born again by the Spirit of God knows that Jesus Christ is absolutely authoritative. Everything he said is true. It's true. He's right. He's God. So his statements are used to oppose the death penalty, and the argument is put out that, well, in the Old Testament, God said, put murderers and other criminals, certain other criminals, to death. But in the New, Jesus changed that. So that's going to be the focus of our investigation. Ideas have consequences. Ideas have consequences. And because so many good people are intimidated, they're intimidated away from aggressively supporting the death penalty, we have a murder epidemic in this country. And in the next so many minutes, we are going to present the New Testament. We'll start with some background in the Old Testament. We'll give the biblical history of execution. And we'll get to the New Testament and the support that Jesus provides for the death penalty. Unambiguous, unequivocal, absolute support for the death penalty. Now, if you cling desperately, if for some reason you want to believe that God is against the death penalty and we should be against the death penalty, then I challenge you. I challenge you, when you finish watching this video, to send me a letter and to let me know what exactly you now think, because we have seen it over the years, countless times, people who've been committed pacifists for years, completely against the death penalty, even against using military force to fight off an invasion. They've looked at this material and have been persuaded on the spot. And that's exciting to us. And we hope it ends up being very exciting to you also. There are six primary arguments against the death penalty that people put forth from the words of the Bible. The very first actually comes from the Old Testament. It is argued that in the Ten Commandments, God said, thou shalt not kill. Therefore, if God said, thou shalt not kill, we should not have the death penalty. Second argument, the Apostle Paul taught believers to bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Repay no one evil for evil. Do not avenge yourselves, but rather give place to wrath. For it is written, vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. I will repay. The death penalty opponents, they have some pretty good ammunition, or so they think. The third argument, Jesus forgave the woman caught in adultery in the very act. And to those arguing that she should be stoned, she should be put to death in obedience to the law of God given through Moses, Jesus said, he who is without sin among you, let him throw a stone at her first. Let him cast the first stone. Wow. Fourth argument against the death penalty from the Bible. Jesus said, you have heard that it was said to those of old, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I tell you, whoever slaps you on your right cheek, turn the other to him also. And the fifth argument from the Bible that people make against the death penalty. Jesus taught believers to forgive. In fact, he said, if you do not forgive men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive you your trespasses. Well, the subject is obviously a spiritual subject. It goes beyond simple public policy. It's a matter, we are told, of the very salvation of your soul. And it turns out that the death penalty is a matter that goes beyond public policy, and it does affect the salvation, but not just of your soul, but of the nation. Because interestingly, God put criminal law at the heart of the Bible. Why did he do that? Why did he put criminal law at the heart of the Bible? In fact, he put it at the heart of evangelism, which is what we'll find out as we continue. And finally, the New Testament teaches Christians not to judge. Isn't that true? Jesus said, judge not that ye be not judged. Imagine a world where people do not judge. It's difficult. In fact, it's reprehensible, because if a man were to abuse a child or a person on a college campus, a man violently rapes a young college student. Can you imagine a world where we don't judge that man? Where we do not decide within us whether that act was right or wrong? Where we do not publicly condemn the rapist? Where we do not prosecute him or punish him? Because we can't judge him. Anyway, those are the arguments that the opponents of the death penalty put forth from the Bible. Now we're going to look at the history of execution in the Bible, and as we proceed, we will address these one by one, and I'd recommend that you fasten your seatbelt. In the first crime recorded in the Bible, Cain murdered his brother Abel. And intuitively, Cain believed that everyone would think themselves justified for executing a murderer. This is interesting. In Genesis chapter 4, verse 14, Cain said to God, "It will happen that anyone who finds me will kill me." Now, where did he get that idea from? Because there were no death penalty advocates at the time, right? There was no conservative Republican Party out there. Cain, the first murderer, knew in his heart that anyone who finds me will kill him, recognizing that they would consider themselves justified in executing a murderer. So God did something very interesting. And we could even say this is the seventh argument against the death penalty. In verse 15, "And the Lord said to Cain, therefore whoever kills Cain, vengeance shall be taken on him sevenfold. And the Lord set a mark on Cain, lest anyone finding him should kill him." That's pretty interesting. Now, what happened? So God forbid the death penalty. There's no death penalty. It's prohibited. From the earliest moments of human history, God forbade the death penalty. Well, in the first centuries, life on earth became unbearable. And we have in Genesis chapter 6, just two chapters later, God looked upon the earth, and indeed it was corrupt. For all flesh had corrupted their ways on the earth. And God said to Noah, "The end of all flesh has come before me, for the earth is filled with violence through them, and behold, I will destroy the earth." Wow, God forbid the death penalty. And centuries, the first centuries of human history, the earth was filled with violence. It was so terrible that God deemed it necessary to destroy all life on the earth except for Noah and his family. Then God did that through the flood. And Noah and his family on the ark, when they came out of the ark within 10 verses in the Bible, Genesis 9, Noah and his family, they come out of the ark. Within 10 verses of the story of exiting the ark, guess what God did? He instituted the death penalty. And it's interesting to see that before the flood, three commands were given, general commands to mankind. And after the flood, three commands. And before the flood, there were only three commands given to mankind. And after the flood, there were only three given up until the covenant of circumcision with Abraham. And we'll look at those commands. Before the flood, in Genesis 1, chapter 28, God said to Adam and Eve, "Be fruitful and multiply. Have dominion over every living thing that moves on the earth." Command number one, before the flood. After the flood, God, in Genesis chapter 9, verses 1 and 2, said again, "Be fruitful and multiply, and now the fear of you shall be on all that move on the earth." Now, why is that? Why, at first God said, "Have dominion over all the animals," and then he said, "The fear of you shall be on the animals." Well, because of the second command that changed. Before the flood, the second command, "Of every tree of the garden you may freely eat, but you shall not eat, and you may eat of every herb, but you shall not eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil." So men, God, when God created Adam and Eve, he said, you can eat any herb, any fruit, anything that grows, vegetation. And that was it. The only one restriction was do not eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. The second command after the flood was every moving thing that lives shall be food for you. Ooh, every moving thing. Now we're talking about animals. God says, I have given you all things, even as the green herbs, but you shall not eat flesh with its life, that is, with its blood in it. So once again, God said, you could eat everything except not this one thing. And there's fascinating symbolic reasons why God did exactly what he did here. But notice that the animals had fear because now men would be eating them. They're very tasty too, by the way. And the third command changed because before the flood, God said, whoever kills Cain, vengeance shall be taken on him sevenfold, prohibiting the death penalty. No execution for murderers. But after the flood, in Genesis 9, verse 6, God said, whoever sheds man's blood, by man his blood shall be shed. For in the image of God, he made man. Notice that before the flood, no death penalty for murderers. After the flood, immediately after the flood, whoever sheds man's blood, by man shall his blood be shed. God changed the law. Now, he didn't do this as a secondary thought, like, wow, I never realized what would happen. He did it. It was part of his plan, part of his intention to teach us some pretty incredible things. What is it that God was trying to teach us when he said no death penalty? And then when he said the swift and certain death penalty? Well, think about this. For all of eternity, there will be people living in heaven with God, human beings and angels and the creatures God created to fill the heavens. And at the same time, there will be others living in the lake of fire. They'll be living in the lake of fire in torment, in separation from God, human beings and angels and Lucifer himself, Satan. And it will be so easy for people to accuse God of being unjust and saying, Lord, how can you do this to them? How can you have them live forever without you in torment, in their loneliness and misery? And God says, I had to do that because they broke the law. They broke the law. And people, even whether people in hell or even human beings in heaven can ask God, but why does that matter? Can't we just not have a law? And so God could point to the first millennium and a half of human history and he can say, look, I gave human beings the opportunity to live without law. They only had their conscience to go by. If they broke the law, even if they murdered someone, vengeance would not be taken on them. There would be no law to break because there was no punishment. They only had to go by the intention of their heart and their conscience. What many theologians have called the dispensation of conscience. You do it because you think it's right. And if you do what is wrong and you murder someone, no one will punish you. And God can show us what did human beings do over those centuries. They became more and more evil, more wicked, more violent. We think of violent crime and murder. We think of the pain inflicted on the family of the victims, right? But think of the pain on the family of the murderers. Let's say you have a 15-year-old son who's murdered a neighbor boy. That destroys families on both ends of the crime. And how about the murderer himself? Do you think there's happiness and joy there in his life? No. The pain, the anguish of lawlessness becomes unspeakable. And in America, we have such a tremendously high crime rate, even though we have some law enforcement. Imagine how evil men became before the flood when there was no law enforcement. It was just your own conscience. So for out for all of eternity, God has laid the foundation to show, to teach, to illustrate the wisdom of His way. Because He can say, they are in torment forever. They are being punished by separation from Me, separation from light and love forever because they have rejected the law. And if I were to let them live in eternity, if I were to let them live in eternity, in heaven, on earth, a lawless life, their misery and pain and torment would be greater. It would be greater than what they're experiencing right now. Not only that, they would inflict it on all of creation. So this is the only just and righteous and even merciful thing I can do. Wow. That's what we learn from studying the history of execution in the Bible. As we go through the Bible and we look at the subject of the death penalty in Genesis 9:6, God said, whoever sheds the blood of man, by man shall his blood be shed. We see that it's repeated a number of times and reinforced and some information added to it as we go through history and through as the Bible more and more people like Ezekiel comes along. He's a prophet of God. He writes his book, Ezekiel. Moses wrote Genesis, but then he got to Exodus. And in Exodus, we find the Ten Commandments in chapter 20. And one of the Ten Commandments we quoted earlier, thou shalt not kill. Thou shalt not kill. Actually, I have a New King James version here. And the New King James says this, as virtually every translation within the last 400 years, you shall not murder. You shall not murder. Now, this is an accurate translation. God, in the very next chapter, said, if anyone strikes a man so that he dies, if anyone is a murderer, he shall surely be put to death. He who kidnaps a man shall surely be put to death. And he goes on and on explaining an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth and life for life. And if you kill an unborn child in Exodus 21, you shall surely be put to death. So how can it be in Exodus 20? How could it be in Exodus 20 that God is saying, do not kill? And then in Exodus 21, repeatedly saying, kill the murderer, kill the kidnapper. If anyone kills an unborn child, put him to death. God would be schizophrenic, right? He'd be contradicting himself. And repeatedly through the entire Old Testament, God is saying, reaffirming that you should execute certain criminals. Well, it turns out in the Hebrew, just as in the English, just as in virtually every language known to humans, there are different words for kill and for murder. There are different words. And sometimes, just like in the English language, those words could overlap a bit, right? If you murder someone, you've killed them. But if you killed someone by, you were chopping down a tree, and lo and behold, your new axe, it was defective, and the axe handle, the axe head, flew off and hit your friend in the head and killed him. You killed your friend, but you didn't murder him. See, murder, there is guilt associated with murder. And killing, there's not necessarily. Well, God said, do not murder. The Hebrew word, and I do not speak Hebrew, but I'm able to look it up. The Hebrew word is ratzach. And it's to murder. And that's the word right here in the Ten Commandments, you shall not murder. Not the Hebrew word for kill, harag. And it's easy to take a concordance, like a Strong's concordance, look up these different words and go through the Bible and you'll find out that those words in the Old Testament occur many times. And the Hebrew word for murder occurs almost always in circumstances where it's talking about murder. Murder, the crime. And kill, if you're killing an animal or you're killing a murderer, you're executing a murderer. All right, God forbid then murder, and he commanded the lawful execution of murderers. Now, some people have said, well, it's true that God did in the Old Testament command the death penalty as an extreme punishment for murder. It was the maximum penalty, but it was optional. People make that argument. It's a shame that they do, because it's absolutely not true. We saw in these passages, God said, you shall surely put him to death, the murderer. And the kidnapper, you shall surely put him to death. Then Moses wrote Genesis and Exodus. Then he got the Leviticus. And in Leviticus, we find chapter 24, verse 17, and we could go on a bit. But we'll look at verse 17. God said, whoever kills any man shall surely be put to death. And I'll go down to verse 22. You shall have the same law for the stranger and one from your own country, for I am the Lord your God. You know, a lot of people use that argument too. They say, well, those laws were only for Israel. Do you know if you go through Moses' law, repeatedly God says, you shall have the same law for the stranger, for the foreigner, as you have for one from your own country, for I am the Lord your God. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, chapter 35, we'll go to. For those people who say the death penalty is a maximum penalty, and it's optional, this is what God said, starting in verse 31. Moreover, you shall take no ransom for the life of a murderer who is guilty of death, but he shall surely be put to death. So you shall not pollute the land where you are, for blood defiles the land, and no atonement can be made for the land for the blood that is shed on it, except by the blood of him who shed it. Wow. Take no ransom for the life of a murderer. Did God change this law in the New Testament? Did God take his well-established law of the death penalty for murderers and other criminals, and did he undo that? Did he repeal that law in the New Testament? Well, what we are going to do now is we are going to look and see that Jesus in the books of Matthew and Mark, that the Apostle Paul in the books of Acts and Romans, that the book of Hebrews and Revelation, they all support aggressively, firmly, and surely the death penalty. Jesus, while he ministered on earth repeatedly, in fact, it was the substance of his ministry, he quoted from the Old Testament. A lot of people say, well, Bob, you shouldn't be using those verses because that's in the Old Testament. And I'll say, well, I'm sorry, I didn't realize that. Here, let me rip it out and get rid of it. And Jesus, when he was on earth, when he quoted from the Bible, how often did he quote from the New Testament? Never. It wasn't written yet. He always quoted from the Old Testament, of course. He said, as Moses said, or as it is written, or as the prophet Isaiah wrote. Right? And so God, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, was not ashamed to quote the Old Testament. He did it for 3 years. Now, some people might argue, well, when he died and rose from the dead, then all that changed. So I asked them, well, then why did God have the apostles write it in the Gospels 30 years later, if it's not valid for us? Of course it's valid, because all Scripture is inspired by God and profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction. Okay, so when Jesus was on earth and ministering, and some of his words were recorded in the Gospels, did he ever talk about the death penalty? Well, actually, yes. Yes, a couple times. In fact, in Exodus chapter 21, where it tells us you should execute the murderer, and you should execute the kidnapper. Well, there are about 15 or so, 20 crimes that God says you should put these people to death. And it's different based on how you count it. like incest, right? God says you put to death someone for committing incest with a father or mother or brother or sister or aunt or uncle. So you could count those differently. But, and God is very clear as to what crimes receive the death penalty and which do not. But two crimes, two actions that God said use the death penalty embarrass Christians more than any other. Two. And they are both in Exodus chapter 21, the chapter right after the Ten Commandments. God said, he who strikes his father or his mother shall surely be put to death. Someone once told me that when a man thinks he's big enough to hit his father, he's never been so small. And it really is an incredibly destructive thing for a man to even think of, never mind actually hit his father or his mother. But you know what is happening in America today? That is becoming commonplace. It's becoming commonplace. In history, probably in the nation, in America, we can go for years, even decades, and not in the whole country have a man hit his father or hit his mother. A man hit his mother? Unspeakable, unheard of. Today, it's becoming commonplace. We have moms that are calling 911 because their children are beating them. In the inner cities, we have mothers cowering in the corner of their empty apartments because their children, who have turned their lives into a living hell on earth, are beating them. Unbelievable what's happened in our country. God said, he who strikes his father or mother shall surely be put to death. God spoke these words to Moses. Moses didn't think them up. They were the words of God, just as authoritative as the Ten Commandments themselves. And then, what, two verses later, verse 17, and this embarrasses Christians more than anything else God ever said. This is the most embarrassing thing to many weak Christians. God said, he who curses his father or his mother shall surely be put to death. If you curse your mother or father, you shall surely be put to death. What is the third leading cause of death of young people in America? Teenagers, high school, college students. Third leading cause of death in the mid-1990s is suicide. They are killing themselves. They grow up with no respect for their parents, with no respect for authority, question authority, no respect for the government, the law, the teacher. Well, it's hard to respect a lot of these authority sources. But no respect for mom or dad. So then you have no respect for yourself. So young girls let guys use them. And they enter years of severe depression. And suicide has become the answer. It's not the answer. But it's become the coward's way out. And so when you reject God, when you get rid of the death penalty, you don't get rid of it. You just shift it and multiply it. You just shift it and multiply it. You get rid of the death penalty for murderers, you have more murder. Well, was Jesus also ashamed of this command? I know that he wasn't. He wasn't at all ashamed of God or God's word or God's commands. In Mark chapter 7 and Matthew chapter 15, Jesus uses that command to show how evil the Pharisees were. Because the Pharisees, Jesus said in Mark chapter 7, verse 9, reject the commandment of God. Notice he says the commandment of God, that you may keep your own tradition. For Moses said, he who curses father or mother, let him be put to death. That's in Mark chapter 7. And in Matthew chapter 15, basically the same teaching. It's a parallel passage, verses 3 and 4. Jesus is slamming the Pharisees. He's angry with them because their tradition, their ideas are more important to them. They carry more weight than God's ideas, than God's tradition. And so Jesus answered and said to the Pharisees and the scribes, why do you disobey the commandment of God because of your tradition? Why do you transgress the commandment of God because of your ideas? For God commanded, saying, honor your father and your mother, and he who curses father or mother, let him be put to death. Wow. He who curses father or mother, let him be put to death. Jesus was not ashamed of God. He was God. He is God, the Son of God. Jesus was not ashamed of God's commands. Well, that was the Old Testament. Yeah, but this is the New Testament. And this is Jesus teaching in the New Testament. Well, we should throw that out, actually, because once he died and rose from the dead, that doesn't count anymore. Well, we are reading in Matthew 15 here, and if we get later in Matthew to where Jesus did die on the cross and where he was resurrected, he was raised from the dead, what does he say? Go into all nations, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. Whoa! That's why God had Matthew write these things in the Gospels. Not so we could forget them as soon as it happened. Jesus said, go to all nations and teach them to observe all things that I have commanded you. The things I have commanded you are the things God commanded you. Because, well, Jesus is God. All right? So Jesus was not ashamed of the commandments of God as so many Christians are. And we see the consequences of laying aside God's commands. We see the consequences right here in America. If we proceeded on in Matthew or in any of the four Gospels, we get to the passage of the crucifixion, like in Luke chapter 23, where Jesus is being crucified, and on his right and his left are two robbers, murderers. And they have also been convicted of capital crimes, and they're being put to death. And one of the two mocked Christ. One of the two, you recall, mocked Christ. But the other man said, Lord, remember me. Remember me when you enter your kingdom. And Jesus said, I say to you, this day you shall be with me in paradise. This day. That man on the cross, what little he knew about Jesus, he put his trust in Christ. He put his eternity, his soul, in Jesus Christ. He trusted his life into his hands. Not his earthly life, he knew he was dying, but his eternal life and his eternal soul. Well, this man whom Jesus had just declared righteous. Here's a brand new baby Christian. He's a believer, right? What did he say about the fact that he was being executed? This is what he said in Luke chapter 23, verse 41. He said, well, first in verse 40, to the other robber who was mocking Jesus, he said, do you not even fear God, seeing that you are under the same condemnation? And we indeed justly, for we receive the due reward for our deeds, but this man has done nothing wrong. You see what this brand new Christian, this babe in Christ, this man that Jesus has just declared righteous, righteous because Christ's righteousness was imputed to him, not because he merited forgiveness or eternal salvation on his own merit. He didn't do good to get to heaven. He put his faith and trust in Christ, and he was truly repentant. He didn't know all the right words to say, but the little bit that God had revealed to him, he believed in God. God said to Abraham, I'm going to multiply your children as the stars of the heavens. And Abraham said, cool. He believed God. He believed God that he would have a lot of kids. And God said, therefore, he justified him and made him righteous. He accounted righteousness to Abraham because he believed the little bit God had said to him. And the thief on the cross believed a little bit, and God accounted it to him for righteousness. That is absolutely cool. Now, not only did Jesus not speak out on the cross and correct this guy, Jesus could have spoken out on their behalf, to stop the injustice, or at least come against it. And he could have said, it's wrong. You can crucify me, but save these two. He didn't do that. What was happening to them was just. And God was not under a compulsion to put the thief on the cross, and we call him a thief, but a robber. And you can see in the Bible and in Greek writings that a robber was often a murderer, right? We can go to Josephus and see he writes about robbers who murdered people on the Temple Mount. But anyway, these guys were criminals convicted of capital crimes, and Jesus could have come to his defense, to their defense, but he didn't. And when this man said, we receive our just punishment, God was not under no compulsion to put that word, those words, into the Bible. God could have left them out. If he was speaking foolishness, if he was saying something ignorant, God didn't have to put it in the Bible. God put it in the Bible because he wanted it there. And God didn't correct it when it got in the Bible. Matthew, Luke, could have corrected it. He said, and he said, we received this punishment justly, but actually God's against the death penalty, so he was mistaken. But he was a new believer, so we overlook it. Right? No. They were receiving their just punishment, as the dying criminal knew. And we'll look real quickly before we get to Paul in the next section. We'll jump to the end of the New Testament in Revelation chapter 13, a fascinating verse, overlooked for sure, but Revelation chapter 13, verse 10, he who kills with the sword must be killed with the sword. Here is the patience and the faith of the saints. Wow, you know, a lot of time, often when that phrase is used, people think it's a passive observation. It's just God noticing the way things go. He who kills with the sword shall die by the sword. That is not just a passive observation. That's a command. That's a command from God. And you only disobey it. You disobey it at the cost of disobeying God. Whatever it means to disobey God, that's what you're doing when you don't teach and encourage, and as governing officials, see to it that murderers are put to death. He who kills with the sword must be killed with the sword. Here is the patience and the faith of the saints. The Apostle Paul did not object to the death penalty. In fact, he was on trial, possibly for his life, in front of Porcius Festus, governor, Roman governor in Caesarea. And he, at that time, he volunteered a strong endorsement for the death penalty, even though he was the one on trial. The Apostle Paul was a Roman citizen. Roman citizens had significant rights in the empire, and Paul knew his rights. In fact, they would arrest him, and he would argue, and he would say, I am a Roman citizen. You can't do this to me, and they'd release him. They were afraid of what they had done. And even here, in this case, we're in Acts chapter 25, when he's before Festus. At the end of it, he appeals to Caesar, and Festus says, you're a Roman citizen, you've appealed to Caesar. You'll go to Caesar. But here's what he said in verse 11, the Apostle Paul, and it's recorded in the book of Acts by Luke, wrote, for if I am an offender, or if I have committed anything worthy of death, I do not object to dying. But if there is nothing in these things of which these men accuse me, no one can deliver me to them. You see what Paul said? If I have committed anything worthy of death, I do not object to dying. Isn't that amazing? Now, if the death penalty was wrong, if the death penalty was a violation of human rights, or a violation of the rights of a Roman citizen, or if it was just fundamentally wrong, like they came and told the apostles, do not speak in the name of Jesus. But they said, no, we must obey God rather than man. So if it was truly wrong to put Paul to death or anyone to death, Paul would not have said, if I am an offender, if I have committed anything worthy of death, I do not object to dying. If it was wrong to put someone to death, you couldn't commit anything worthy of death. You couldn't do it. And if you did something that people thought was worthy of death, you should object to dying. Because even from jail, Paul can write epistles to the church, so he can be effective alive. Well, then we get to one of Paul's own epistles, the book of Romans. And Romans 13, many people know the passage saying to obey the governing authorities. To the extent that the government is not telling you to disobey God, to that extent, you should obey the government. If the government says disobey God, then you have to obey God, and in the process, you disobey the government. That teaching is from the beginning of the Bible through to the end. The Hebrews Hall of Faith, in the book of Hebrews, half of the people in the Hall of Faith did what they did by disobeying the governing authorities, and it says, and they did so by faith. So we'll get to that Romans 13 in just 1 minute, but let's start at the end of Romans 12, because the end of Romans 12 is the ammunition for so many who oppose the death penalty, and they use the Bible to do it. The Apostle Paul wrote this in verse 17, repay no one evil for evil. Repay no one evil for evil. Verse 19, do not avenge yourselves, but rather give place to wrath. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. You see that? Paul says, don't repay evil for evil, and do not avenge yourselves, but give place to wrath. There's a place for wrath. It's not with you. Don't repay evil for evil. Don't take vengeance. Do not avenge yourselves, because there's a place for wrath. And the pacifists, the liberal Christians, they say, see, it's wrong. You shouldn't do it, the death penalty. But it's sad that they stop right there, because if they were to continue, Romans 13, two verses later, Romans 13, 1, let every soul be subject to the governing authorities. Right? As the general rule, everyone should obey the government, except when the government tells you to disobey God. Like the Hebrew midwives in Exodus chapter 1, where Pharaoh said to them to kill the children as they're being born from the Hebrew mothers, because there were too many Hebrews, too many Jews in Egypt, Pharaoh thought. And what did they do? They disobeyed Pharaoh. And they lied to him. He called them in and said, why aren't you doing this? Why aren't you killing them? And they said, well, we would, but the Hebrew women give birth too fast. And we can't get there in time. They're not like the Egyptian women who give birth slowly. So they not only disobeyed Pharaoh, they lied to him in order to save lives. And God blessed them and gave the midwives families of their own. It Moses wrote in the text. Okay, so let every soul be subject to the governing authority. Verse 3, Romans 13, for the governing authorities, the rulers, are not a terror to those who do good works, but to those who do evil. See, the governing authorities are a terror, or should be, to those who do evil works. Verse 4, for the governing authority, for he is God's minister. The governing authority is God's minister to you for good. But if you do evil, be afraid, for he does not bear the sword in vain. For he is God's minister, an avenger, to execute wrath on him who practices evil. Do you see what we're being told right here? Yes, it's true that believers should not avenge themselves. You know, that teaching, that's not a New Testament teaching. That's an Old Testament teaching. We see that in Leviticus and in Proverbs. Leviticus 19, verse 18? You shall not take vengeance nor bear any grudge against the children of your people, but you shall love your neighbor as yourself. It's not like God had one standard of righteousness in the Old Testament and a brand new one in the New Testament. It's not like that. That is not it. loving your neighbor was the same in the Old and the New Testament. It's not like the law in the Old Testament was unrighteous or unloving. It's not like that. God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Jesus Christ, I'm the Lord thy God. I change not. His essential righteousness doesn't change. So it is wrong to take personal vengeance. But when Paul said, do not avenge yourselves, but give place to wrath, there is a place for wrath. There's a place for vengeance. That place is with God. But God sometimes delegates authority because he's God and he can do that. God can do that. It may be the father's job to water the lawn, but he may tell his 9-year-old son, water the lawn. And the son will do it in obedience to the father, but he might disobey his father. He might disobey his father. And God has told the governing authorities that they are the place for wrath and vengeance and terror, and to execute the evildoers. For the governing authorities are a terror to evildoers. They are God's minister. And if that governing authority does not bear the sword, then the sword is used to execute in vain. For he is God's minister, an avenger to execute wrath on him who practices evil. That is God's role, God's desire, God's command for the governing authority is to stand in the place of God, just like a father stands in the place of God and loves and nurtures his son. God loves and nurtures us if we allow him to. And God wants the father in the family to help to love and nurture the son, just as God the Father in heaven would. So the son could learn about God the Father in heaven from his earthly father. And so to the pastor that feeds the flock, feeds the sheep. For God established 3 institutions, the family, the church, and the government. And all 3 should be ministers and obey God so that people can learn about their heavenly father by looking at their authorities on earth. And how else will people learn that their eternal father, their father in heaven, will send some people off to death? To death. Not just an earthly death, but an eternal death. Because sin is real and it's destructive. Lawlessness destroys, and it has the potential to destroy forever unless repentance occurs and we go to God to forgiveness. So when earthly governments refuse to enforce the swift death penalty, then the masses begin to ignore God and they mock God because there is no eternal death. There is no second death. There is no lake of fire because there's no certain death for murderers on this earth. So what would make these people of short vision and a lack of wisdom think there would be an ultimate punishment when you can get away with it here on earth? That is why God put criminal justice at the heart of the death, at the heart of evangelism. That's why the death penalty is at the heart of the gospel. And Jesus Christ died for us. He died for us. And the thief on the cross said, we are getting our just punishment. God supports the death penalty. And the Apostle Paul firmly and aggressively and unashamedly supported, and still does today, the death penalty. The author of the book of Hebrews supports the death penalty, but he comes at it from that spiritual perspective. The question is, how can people be certain of eternal judgment? Well, the certainty of punishment under the Mosaic law or under criminal law proves the certainty of punishment for rejecting Jesus Christ. In the book of Hebrews, chapter 10, verses 28 and 29, this is what we read. Anyone who has rejected Moses' law dies without mercy on the testimony of 2 or 3 witnesses. Right? Notice that you reject Moses' law. In other words, you murder or kidnap. So you've rejected Moses' law. You're a lawbreaker. You die without mercy, which is the way the government should operate toward criminals. Anyone who has rejected Moses' law dies without mercy. Of how much worse punishment do you suppose will he be thought worthy who tramples underfoot the Son of God? You see the argument there? People can know that if you disobey the law, you'll be put to death. That's a pretty serious punishment. How much of a worse punishment is there for someone who rejects Jesus Christ, the author of the law? That is a powerful argument for evangelism. What a sermon you could preach on that. But today, kids grow up knowing that you get away with murder, you get away with adultery, you get away with selling pornography. So probably you'll get away with it forever because we can't see eternity. We can only see what's in front of our face. That's why the law is the great teacher. All right, so the book of Hebrews supports the death penalty as a tool of evangelism to teach people of the severity and the certainty of God's judgment. Temporal punishment through the law teaches men about God. And if the government neglects the death penalty, then people scoff at the second death. And there is nothing Christians can do to change that. If you disobey God, there is a great consequence ahead. And when we disobey God, because we're ashamed of Him, we're ashamed of His wisdom and His laws, His truth, then people scoff at the gospel and they go to hell because of it. In Psalm 58, verses 10 and 11, an interesting passage. A lot of Christians, they never heard this one before, but it's right there and it's good. The righteous shall rejoice when he sees the vengeance. The righteous shall rejoice when he sees the vengeance. In verse 11, men will say, surely there is a reward for the righteous, and surely he is God who judges in the earth. Right? We want to see righteousness. We want to see God's judgment on earth. We want to see it. You see a movie, a shoot 'em up movie, and finally at the end, the bad guys really get it. And people love that. There's something inside of us that we want to see righteousness and justice and vengeance. Vengeance is not bad. It's good. God owns vengeance. He just wants to do it right. He doesn't want us to take personal vengeance. Now, there are others in the New Testament that support the death penalty too, like the two, well, angels, for example, and the two witnesses in the book of Revelation. We'll just go there real quickly. But Revelation chapter 16, verses 5 and 6. Verse 5, you can hear the angels saying, you are righteous, O Lord. You are righteous. And then turning the topic on those sinners in the tribulation, he says, for they have shed the blood of the saints and the prophets, and you, O Lord, have given them blood to drink, for it is their just due. Righteousness, justice. Wow. Revelation chapter 11, the two witnesses that God has, and verse 5, it's so interesting. If anyone wants to harm them, he must be killed. If anyone wants to harm them, he must be killed. And guess what? They set about defending themselves. God gives them the ability to defend themselves. The New Testament is filled with firm support for execution, the death penalty. So the woman caught in the act of adultery, the story is reported to us in the Gospel of John, the only one of the four Gospels that tell us about it, in chapter 8. And the woman caught in the act of adultery, brought by Pharisees to Jesus, and they say, what should we do with her? Moses said to stone her. What do you say? And Jesus effectively forgave her and let her go, and mocked and humiliated the Pharisees in the process. Well, that story is used by the opponents of the death penalty to say, see, Jesus repealed the death penalty. He let the adulteress go. We've just seen that the Old and New Testaments are filled with support for the death penalty. Why did Jesus let her go? Well, ask yourself this question. Does God have the authority to forgive? And can God forgive without repealing the law, without negating the law? Of course he can. Did God repeal or negate the law in the Old Testament? No, no one would ever even dream of arguing so. They only make that mistake in the New Testament. All right, if God didn't repeal or negate the law in the Old Testament, then did he ever forgive an adulterer or an adulteress? Yes, he did, a number of times. Hosea, the prophet. Hosea's wife, Gomer, was an adulteress. She was a terrible, evil woman. And God wanted to teach something to Israel and to the world. And he said to Hosea, forgive your wife, forgive her, and take her back. Because God was trying to show how much he loved Israel and how much he loves the world and how much he wants to take us back if we will only repent. So God forgave Gomer in the Old Testament, but he didn't negate the law. How about King David? King David committed adultery with Bathsheba. And then her husband, Uriah the Hittite, he had him murdered so his sin wouldn't be found out. But it was too late. Pretty much it was found out. In fact, in 2 Samuel chapter 12, verse 13, Nathan the prophet, when God forgave King David for his adultery and his murder, and he basically made a conscious decision to not inflict the death penalty on David, because that would have been the natural course of events. But here's what Nathan said to David, the Lord also has put away your sin, you shall not die. You see that? God has the authority to forgive, but we're not God. So we can't forgive someone's sins. We can only forgive someone who has hurt us. We can only forgive them to the extent that they've hurt us. So God's law remained in effect. We can read in Psalms, Psalm 1, Psalm 19, Psalm 119, 78, 89. God's law is in effect, even though David in Psalm 32 is saying, Lord, thank you for forgiving me. Thank you that you forgave me for my sins. So God forgave the New Testament adulteress just as he forgave the Old Testament adulteress and adulterer. God has the authority to do that. Now, another point on this story in John chapter 8, the woman caught in the act of adultery, is that these Pharisees were not coming to Jesus sincerely wanting to know what should we do. They were trying to trick Jesus. They were trying to trap him. Let's trick Jesus. They were trying to get him into a premature conflict with the Roman authorities. Because, well, here's what it says in the text in verse 6. This they said, testing him, that they might have something of which to accuse him. Right? Hey, Jesus, what should we do to her? She committed adultery. They knew that Rome had revoked the Jews' authority to execute criminals. In fact, John is the only gospel writer to let us know that. In John chapter 18, verse 31, the Jews had said to Pilate said to the Jews, you take him, Jesus, and you judge him according to your law. Therefore, the Jews said to him, it is not lawful for us to put anyone to death. They were asking Pilate. They wanted him crucified. Right? And so John explains it to us. If Jesus would have said, put her to death, that was the true and correct answer, but they were trying to get him in trouble with Rome, with Pilate, with Caesar. Let's get him in trouble with the government, then he'll be off our hands. He'll be their problem, not ours. But Jesus was too smart for them. But unfortunately, very superficial Christians and many unbelievers take this material and they misuse it, and as a result, they distort the teachings of God on this very important subject. So, we can also consider this, that Jesus did not there repeal the law. He didn't do it. In fact, Galatians 4:4 teaches us that Jesus was born of a woman, born under the law. He was born under the law. And he came in Matthew chapter 5. some fascinating passages in the Sermon on the Mount. Matthew 5, verses 17, 18, 19. Jesus said, "Do not think that I have come to destroy the law. I didn't come to destroy it. Assuredly, I say to you, till heaven and earth pass away, not one jot or one tittle will by no means pass from the law, till all is fulfilled. Whoever does these things and teaches men so shall be called great in the kingdom." So Jesus did not undo the law. In fact, in Matthew chapter 8, verse 4, he said, offer the gift. He healed someone, and he said, offer the gift that Moses commanded. And in Matthew 23, he's slamming the Pharisees for their hypocrisy. And he said, they sit in Moses' seat. So do what they say. Don't do what they do. Don't do what they do because they're hypocrites. Do what they say because they sit in Moses' seat. In other words, Jesus always elevated the authority of Moses. Always. Always, always, always. Never the reverse. John chapter 7, Jesus said, "Did not Moses give you the law? Yet none of you keep the law. And the law of Moses should not be broken." Some cool stuff. And we've already mentioned earlier where Jesus said, after he died and rose from the dead, he said, "Go into all nations and teaching them all things, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you." Matthew 28, 19 and 20. And years later, years after all this, James and all the elders said to Paul in Acts chapter 21, verse 20, "You see, brother, how many myriads of Jews there are who believe, and they're all zealous for the law." They're all zealous for the law. Now, Jesus did not repeal the law. The Apostle Paul taught that the entire unrepentant world is under the law, and that the law is designed to show them their guilt and to bring them to Christ. Again, 1 Timothy chapter 1, verses 8, 9, and 10. Paul writes that we know the law is good if you use it lawfully, knowing this, that the law is not made for the righteous man, but for the unrighteous, the ungodly, for sinners, for murderers. He lists all these. The law is for murderers, for sodomites, for adulterers, for kidnappers, for perjurers. Wow. So the law is for them in hopes of bringing them to Christ. In Romans chapter 3, verse 19, that the law, all the world is under the law. The law speaks to those who are under the world. And what does it say to them? That they are guilty before God. You see that? And in Galatians chapter 3, verses 24 and 25, notice how the law is the tool of evangelism. Therefore, the law was our tutor to bring us to Christ, that we might be justified by faith. But after faith has come, we are no longer under a tutor. But the law is our tutor to bring us to Christ. It's so exciting. So those Christians who ignorantly argue against God's law are arguing against the number one tool of evangelism God has given us. Because if people don't know they're lawbreakers, they don't need a Savior. If people do not know they're sinners, they do not need forgiveness. And that, unfortunately, is what liberal Christians are doing to destroy the chances for salvation for countless millions. Kids, children who are growing up lawless, thinking that fornication is okay, and adultery is okay because it's been decriminalized. God knows better than anyone else what acts are criminal and what crimes are capital crimes. Christians who are untutored in the evangelistic role of the law oppose the foundation of the criminal code upon God's law, and they do that to our detriment. Now we address the argument from the opposition, turn the other cheek. And it seems powerful because they're quoting Jesus. In the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew, the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 5, in verses 38 and 39, Jesus said, "You have heard that it was said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I tell you not to resist an evil person, but whoever slaps you on your right cheek, turn the other to him also. And that, we are told, is the principle. That is the principle that we should live our lives by and the principle that we should apply to criminal justice. Pacifists have an unworkable interpretation of Jesus' plain teaching here in this passage and throughout the Sermon on the Mount. For example, imagine applying a pacifist worldview to a woman who's being raped. And the pacifist says, well, don't resist the enemy. And if your neighbor, if your enemy wants you for 1 hour, stay with him too. I mean, those are literally sick concepts. Sick concepts, and absolutely abhorrent to God. Abhorrent to God, because God clearly has shown us in the Bible that we should defend ourselves, defend our families. Anybody wants to hurt our children, we defend them. We defend them. A lot of people falsely presume, and pacifists all, that this teaching, that this is a New Testament teaching, and that the Old Testament was different. But that's not true. We could go to the Old Testament, Proverbs chapter 24, verse 29, and we read, "Do not say, I will do to him just as he has done to me." Right? That's an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. The teaching in the Old Testament, do not say, I will do to him just as he has done to me. That's an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth, right? Don't say that. Well, why not don't say that? Because that teaching, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth, is governmental. It's for the governing authorities. It's not personal. We're not to take vengeance into our own hands. It's too powerful of a thing. We'll blow it. We'll mess it up. Vengeance is for God, and he has delegated to the governing authorities. He hasn't even delegated it to our pastors or elders or deacons. No, he's delegated it, and not to fathers. If someone hurts or kills a father's son, he is not to go and kill them back. He is to leave it for the governing authorities to take vengeance. And that's exactly what Jesus, in the Sermon on the Mount, it's not about governmental policy. It's so obvious if you just look at it. Matthew chapter 5, 6, blessed are the poor in spirit. He's not talking about national criminal code. He's talking about the heart of the believer. Blessed are the poor in spirit. And he says, if you're angry with your brother, if your brother has something against you, right? If you've committed lust in your heart. That's what Jesus is talking about. He's not talking about perjury or punishment, restitution. He's not talking about those things. In fact, in the very Sermon on the Mount, Jesus himself makes the distinction between the believer's heart attitude and the government and government officials. Because in verses 25 and 26, he's talking about, well, you better do the right thing, because if you don't, the judge will get you. And the judge will hand you over to the officer, and they'll punish you. See, and he wasn't saying here, and the judge is bad for doing that, and the officer shouldn't do his role. He wasn't saying that. There's one role for the person, the individual, and another role for the government. And when we usurp someone else's authority or their role, we're sinning. So we should not usurp a father's role or a pastor's role or a government's role if we're not in that position ourselves. So if a father usurps the government's role, he's doing the wrong thing if he wants to kill someone out of vengeance. And vice versa, if the government wants to usurp the father's role and the government wants to raise kids and feed them and change their diapers, put them in school, get them help, that's wrong too. God has given each institution their realm of responsibility and authority. And they shouldn't merge them and blend them and combine them in a godless, unbiblical way. There's another way for me to prove to you that Jesus was not here repealing the law. Because in the Sermon on the Mount, he was not even, once he gets into these examples, he was not even talking about the law. He was talking about false interpretation, misinterpretation of the law. Jesus wasn't criticizing God's law. He had just said that I have not come to destroy it, and heaven and earth will pass away. Not one jot or tittle of the law will pass until heaven and earth pass away. So the next, you know, two verses later, he's not then repealing the law. He'd be contradicting himself. What he is doing, and you'll see clearly, is he is criticizing the misinterpretation of the law. How do we know that? Because normally, if Jesus is going to talk about the law or anything in the Old Testament, he introduces it with a formulation, one of a few types. He'll say, it is written, or as Isaiah said, or that which was spoken by the prophet Jonah, or Moses said. That's the normal New Testament formulation to introduce an Old Testament quote. But here in this section, Jesus uses a very unusual formulation. This is what he says. He said, you have heard that it was said to them of old, to those of old. You have heard that it was said to those of old. He uses that repeatedly. Now, why does he use that strange formulation? Because he's not talking about what was written. He was talking about what is being said about what was written and what was said to those of old. Do you understand that? He's talking about, you have heard that it was said to those of old, but I'm telling you the true way to understand and to apply the Word of God. So, we have it right here. You have heard that it was said to those of old, you shall not murder. You have heard that it was said to those of old, you shall not commit adultery. Furthermore, it has been said. That's no way to introduce an Old Testament scripture, but it has been said. This is what people are saying, and then Jesus is going to correct their sayings. Again, you have heard that it was said to those of old, verse 33, Matthew 5. And you have heard that it was said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth, but I tell you, turn the other cheek. And how about this one in Matthew 5, 43 and 44? And this proves beyond any shadow of a doubt that Jesus is not talking about the law. He's talking about what people say about the law. Listen to this. Jesus said, you have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies. Guess what? That passage, that command is not in the Bible. You can search the Old Testament and you'll be searching for a long time. You'll never find it. To love your neighbor and hate your enemy. That's not the Word of God. That's not the law. Jesus was not criticizing the law. He was criticizing what you have heard that it was said to those of old. Do you see the chain? Sort of like playing phone tag. He was criticizing their phone tag and they were getting it wrong and he was giving it to them right. Jesus was not adjusting the law. He's correcting the misapplication of the law. Here's the law, and here's the criminal law, and you can even apply that to your own personal life. The law says don't murder. You shouldn't be angry without cause. The law says don't commit adultery. You shouldn't lust. You see? The law says an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth, but you should forgive and show mercy and have compassion. In your personal life, you should not avenge, because vengeance is mine, and God delegates it to the governing authorities. Further, if Jesus did really repeal this, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth, hereby saying, you have heard that it was said an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth, but I say to you, turn the other cheek. Well, did he also repeal these other laws? Did he also repeal the law against murder? Because he said the same thing. You have heard that it was said to those of old, you shall not murder, but I say to you, don't be angry. Oh, so he must repeal, do not murder is now no longer a law. We can't have that law. We read it in the Sermon on the Mount. I'm a liberal Christian, and I have an open mind, and my brains have dripped out, and they're all around my feet now. That's it. Can't have the law against murder. And you have heard that it was said to those of old, you shall not commit adultery. But I say to you, don't have lust in your heart. So that law is gone. Oh, we can get rid of all these laws. No, that would be a total mishandling of the Word of God, and that's wrong to do. The punishment side of God's criminal justice system in the Mosaic Law is directed to governments who were commanded to execute criminals and not to individuals. Jesus was correcting a misinterpretation. He was not laying out governmental policy. Who can forgive whom? We are told those who argue against the death penalty say that we should forgive murderers. What do they want to do to the murderer? Conservative Christians, those who take God's word literally, Old and New Testaments, want to execute them. We want to have them put to death. What does the liberal or pacifist Christian, what do they want to see happen to the murderer? They want to incarcerate him, put him to jail, put him in jail. And what do they want to do to the thief? Well, they want to make him pay a fine or put him in jail or make him pay restitution. Ask yourself, is that forgiveness? If you have a murderer and they say, forgive him, and you put him in jail, is that forgiveness? I thought when you forgive someone, you don't also punish him. You've forgiven him. See, their forgiveness is hypocritical. It's not true. It's a lie. It's a distortion. It's false spirituality. They're not more loving than the rest of us. What they want to do is usurp God's authority. They don't want to do away with punishment. They want to be the one to decide to mete out what type of punishment is going to apply here. They reject God's penalty so that they can creatively come up with their own ineffective penalty. And that is rebellion and hard-heartedness, masquerading itself as compassion and love. You know, can you forgive the murderer? Well, you can forgive someone who owes you a debt, but you can't forgive someone who owes me a debt, can you? For example, if your neighbor owes you $100, and you loaned your neighbor $100, generally it's better not to borrow or lend, but it's not an ironclad rule. Sometimes, okay, you lend your neighbor $100, and then he loses his job because the plant closed, and you feel sorry for him. And so you say, you know what? You don't have to pay me back. It's a gift. Now, that was really kind of you to do that. And if your neighbor really, it wasn't his fault, if he's not just a lazy bum and he just quit, right, because he didn't want to work, but he really, things were against him, that was kind and loving of you. But let's say somebody owes me $100. Do you have the authority or standing to go to them and say, you don't have to pay Bob back. That's okay. I forgive you. You can't do that. Don't do that. You can't do it. It would be wrong. The same is true, not only financial debt. God uses financial debt in the Bible as an illustration to teach us about sin and criminal debt and spiritual debt, because we do not have the authority to forgive men's sins, and especially not unrepentant sins. Not God has the authority to forgive sin, but he does not forgive the unrepentant sinner. Right? So if someone murders your neighbor, you can't forgive them of that sin. You can't do it. You could only forgive them to the extent that their crime has hurt you. And if someone in your community or your country gets murdered, it does hurt all of us. And to that extent, on a personal basis, we should forgive. But we don't have the standing to forgive the crime itself. Oh, and by the way, Jesus makes this, he doesn't confuse the simple truth when he teaches us to forgive. What did he say? I don't even have to turn the page. In Matthew chapter 6, forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Right? Jesus knew, you forgive your debtors, those who are indebted to you, those who have wronged you, you forgive them. So the parents of a murder victim, right? Their daughter's been murdered. They can't forgive the murderer for his crime, but they can forgive him to the extent that they've been hurt. And that requires a tremendous amount of forgiveness because they've been hurt to a terribly great degree. They have been really hurt. And guess what, in America? It's so sad that our government mocks their grief, because our government gives mercy where it shouldn't to the murderer. And then that mom, her broken heart, that wound is reopened every time this murderer comes up for an appeal. or he's trying to get out, trying to get to a halfway house, or released on probation, or his photograph gets in the newspaper because he's playing basketball in prison, right? Every time that wound is reopened and she needs to forgive him, and we make it harder for her to get on with her life and to forgive him because we mock her in her grief, because we disobey God. We need to obey God and have the courage to say yes when the media and the liberals, hey, Christians out there, whenever you find yourself in agreement with the leaders in the media and the universities, you know, they're against the death penalty too, then at least use that as an indicator that maybe my ideas might be wrong. Maybe I should go back to the Word of God and see what God says, because it's very rare that God and Phil Donahue agree with one another. It's very rare. And you will find Phil Donahue and a whole parade of liberal slime, literally, who despise God and despise the death penalty. Why? Because if they can discredit the death penalty, then they've discredited God and the justice system that God has revealed to us. Now, all I have to do is turn one more page again after Jesus said, forgive our debtors, to get to their other argument, that where Jesus said, judge not that ye be not judged. They say, see, those who oppose the death penalty, we're not supposed to judge. And you can ask, so you're saying I'm wrong? They say, yeah. How can you say that? You say we're not supposed to judge. Everyone who criticizes you, every liberal who criticizes you for judging, is being a hypocrite because they're judging you. But Jesus did not say, judge not, period. Like that's the end of the story. Don't judge. Life would be unlivable, unworkable if we were not to judge. In fact, in John chapter 7, verse 24, Jesus said, judge with righteous judgment. Do not judge according to outward appearance, but judge with righteous judgment. And even here in John chapter 7, Jesus did not say, judge not, period. Judge not like a hypocrite. Judge not with on outward appearance. Judge righteously. He said, Matthew chapter 7, verse 1, judge not that ye be not judged. How can you say to your brother, let me remove the speck out of your eye, and look, you have a plank in your own eye. Jesus said, don't judge like a hypocrite. Hypocrite, he said in verse 5. Wow, Jesus is calling people hypocrites. And he's not even speaking to the religious leaders. Isn't that amazing? Jesus called people names. Hypocrite, first, remove the plank from your own eye so that you can see clearly to remove the speck out of your brother's eye. You see that? Judge righteously. Jesus paid Simon the Pharisee a compliment in Luke chapter 7 when he said to him, you have judged rightly. You judge rightly, Simon. How about the Apostle Paul? We'll go to 1 Corinthians chapter 6. Where do Christians get this ignorant idea that we're not supposed to judge? The Apostle Paul says, do you not know that the saints will judge the world? You'll judge the angels? Cool. He goes on to say in verse 2, are you unworthy to judge the smallest matters? You're going to judge the world. Can't you judge smaller matters? He says in verse 5, I say this to your shame. Is there not a wise man among you? Not even one who will be able to judge between his brethren? How about go back a couple chapters? First Corinthians chapter 2, verse 15. Paul tells us in 16 that we have the mind of Christ. We have the mind of Christ. Therefore, he who is spiritual judges all things. Of course we judge. There's a whole book in the Bible called Judges, right? Judges. We have to judge. If we don't judge our neighbor, we do them a terrible disservice, because if they're doing evil, God says clearly, if your neighbor, if someone is doing evil, they're destroying themselves, if you don't warn them, then I will require their blood at your hands, because you knew they were doing evil and you kept silent. That's called apathy, and apathy is hatred. but Christians, liberal Christians, present it as a deeper form of love. I don't judge because I'm a loving person. You don't judge because you're apathetic. You don't care enough about your neighbor or your son or your good friend to tell them you shouldn't be living together. That is evil. That's evil to do what you're doing. But no, you love them so much they'll go right to hell and they won't even have to pause when they're passing you to get there. It's right on by. Moses and the law of God condemns and judges sinners. As Jesus said, don't think I'm accusing you to the Father. He said, there is one who accuses you, even Moses. Moses, and condemned. In John chapter 3, we all know verse 16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, so that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Isn't that beautiful? That's the gospel. That's like the only gospel most Christians want to talk about. That's it. They put a big period there. But it goes right on to the next verse. Jesus said, if you believe, but he who does not believe is condemned already. So people are condemned and they're in guilt. But so many Christians say we shouldn't judge. So we leave them in their ignorance and their wickedness. It's pretty bad. Paul teaches this, mentioned earlier, Romans 3:19, that the law says to those who are under the law that all the world is guilty before God. That's the message of the law. So we have to judge them. We have to do it. In Proverbs chapter 24, verse 25, those who rebuke the wicked will have delight, and a good blessing will come upon them. Isn't that so cool? That's the kind of teaching from God that gives me the courage to go on. Because when you rebuke people, that takes a lot of energy. Confrontation is rough. Judgment is work. It's work. If you do it righteously, and that means if you have a plank in your own eye, get it out first, and then you can see the speck in your brother's eye. So there's a lot to it, this judgment stuff, but it comes directly from God. And he has appointed us as judges. I'm ashamed of you. Is there not one, even one, who could judge among the least of these problems? Don't you know you're going to judge the world? You have to start practicing. Let's get out there and let's judge. Because the judgment comes from Christ, and we have the mind of Christ, and he who is spiritual judges all things. So let's judge in the name of Christ to bring forgiveness and mercy to the lost. God promises that the death penalty is a deterrent. For example, in the book of Deuteronomy, the fifth book of the books that Moses wrote, Deuteronomy chapter 17, verses 12 and 13. The man who acts presumptuously and will not obey the judge, that man shall die. So you shall put away the evil person. Verse 13. And all the people shall hear and fear and no longer act presumptuously, no longer openly defy the law. Openly defy authority. Wow, that's a promise. Isn't that a promise from God that the death penalty will be a deterrent? Well, then why is it no deterrent in America? Because we don't have the death penalty. We don't. Effectively, we have no death penalty. Because what do we have, an average of 100 executions a year or so and 24,000 murders a year? The fraction is so tiny, the chances of being put to death, it's like it's more likely you're going to win a pick three lotto for the day than get executed. Solomon taught us a principle in Ecclesiastes that every parent knows or should know. And that's this. If you're going to punish your child, you do it swiftly. The punishment should occur right as soon as the parent becomes aware of the infraction. If the child disrespects someone, hits somebody, steals something, uses foul language, then you punish the child right then, swiftly. It makes no sense to punish a week later or a month later And that's why so many people who really go for child discipline from a biblical perspective, they don't like grounding kids. One brother hits his other brother, so you ground him for 2 weeks because he really socked him hard. And so over 2 weeks, every day, that one brother becomes more and more bitter against his other brother. That's what you've done. That's what you've done. Just like you put somebody in jail for 20 years for raping a woman, over 20 years, that man grows to utterly hate and despise that woman. That's what we've done because we ignore God. God says that the punishment should be executed swiftly. And if you don't execute the punishment swiftly, then you'll have a crime epidemic. And that's what we have. Here in Ecclesiastes chapter 8, verse 11, Solomon wrote, "Because the sentence against the evildoer is not executed speedily, therefore the heart of the sons of men is fully set in them to do evil." Fully set in them. If you tell a young schoolboy, well, don't cut school today, because if you do, in 5 years, we'll make you stay after one day. That'll be no deterrent. So when a murderer is executed, 14 years, three appeals, you know, after his crime, society has forgotten who his victim was. Who did that guy kill? Who's he? We've largely forgotten all about him. It's no deterrent. It's not a deterrent. But if you have a murderer who is, even oftentimes we have somebody commit a murder and you find him with a murder weapon in his hand and he confesses. He did it, right? And then they have a trial that gets completed sometime over the next year or two. It's like, what do they have a trial for? He confessed. A trial is to find out whether you're innocent or guilty. If you say, "I'm guilty," they still have them. Blows your mind. Blows your mind how corrupt. And why is our criminal justice system corrupt? Because the death penalty is the foundation. It's the cornerstone of the criminal justice system. So if the death penalty is corrupt and goes weak, then the whole building collapses. And that's what's happened. We have no justice system in America, as many of our judges will brag. It has nothing to do with justice. It's the law. Well, that is an evil notion that most of our judges fully subscribe to. So when a murderer is not executed swiftly, then men's hearts are fully set in them to do evil. So what is the solution to the crime epidemic in America? The first solution, we Christians, those of us who know right from wrong, we need to aggressively support and work toward a swift death penalty. Not just pro-death penalty, but a swift death penalty. So you and I need to stand together firmly and boldly in support of the death penalty. Why do we need to do that? To obey God, to love Him, to serve Him, and for the good of those in our country, in our world, believers and unbelievers. Because if we do that, there will be fewer murderers, and people will be more inclined to listen to the gospel, because it won't be a total contradiction compared to the world around them. Now, it's very helpful when the law supports your evangelism. But when the law works against evangelism, then, wow, it's really hard to overcome that. That's an unnecessary impediment toward spreading the gospel. And God designed it to be the other way, that the governing officials would be God's minister to execute wrath on the criminals. So that if you disobey the law, you die without mercy, and then we could show people, and guess what happens if you reject Jesus? There is an eternal death. See how we need it? Supporting the death penalty is not just an issue. It's salvation. It's eternity. Let's look at it spiritually. You have two options normally for a murderer. You could either put him to death or put him in prison, put him in jail, incarcerate him. Well, which answer One's an answer, another's a problem. Which option is more likely to bring about the salvation of the murderer, to get him to repent? Which option? Well, we know what happens to murderers, criminals, when you put them in jail for 10 years, 20, 30, 40 years. What happens? Well, they become more and more angry. Their hatred builds. They get filled with lust and bitterness. That's what happens. Prison is a school for criminals. You put all the low-life elements of society together, and they teach one another how to be better criminals and how to hate God and how to hate others and how to hate themselves. It's a big idea. God nowhere in the Bible says to incarcerate people for punishment. God approves of only three types of punishment: the death penalty, corporal punishment like flogging, for example, and restitution. That's it. Those three are simple, effective, and inexpensive. They work. They deter. Okay, so prison, that doesn't get people saved, even prison ministries. I mean, some people get saved in prison, but overall, it's a huge failure. How do we know? The recidivism rate, people who go to prison, they come out and they commit another crime, right? It's unbelievable. What percentage? We have career criminals. So people don't really, in large numbers, get converted in prison. It doesn't happen. They don't have positive life-changing experiences in jail. But how about people who are being executed? Do those people get saved? Well, it's hard to figure that out because there haven't been all that many studies about it. I mean, you could, how do you do research on something like that? You read historical accounts of people who have been executed. You find out, well, were they evangelized at the time? Did they repent or did they not repent? It's hard to find studies like that. There aren't any that I can think of, except for one. Yeah, there's one. Where is it? I have it right here. There's one study like that right here, right on Calvary, on the top of Mount Moriah. Jesus Christ was crucified. Did you know it was the same mountain where Abraham offered up Isaac, on Mount Moriah, where they built the temple in Jerusalem? On the top of that mountain, right near the peak, Jesus Christ was crucified, and on the two sides of him, two criminals were being put to death. And one mocked God, and the other said, "Jesus, remember me when you enter your kingdom." He was sorry. He was repentant. So what's the percentage of conversion there? Wow, pretty good, 50%. One out of two. Jesus said, "Assuredly, I say to you, this day you will be with me in paradise." Isn't that neat? There are no atheists in foxholes, right? As a general rule, there are no atheists in foxholes. You tell somebody you're going to die tomorrow evening during prime time. That's when we should have executions. You're going to die tomorrow. Prepare your soul. Here's a man then on the threshold of eternity. What is he going to do? He has every opportunity to ask God to forgive him and to turn the security of his soul over to the Lord. He has every opportunity to do that. And you lock him up like an animal, worse than an animal, for 30 or 40 years, and he gets more and more bitter. God's way is the right way. Now, there's a lot of Christians out there, theologically minded Christians, whom I really love because theology is the greatest issue in the world for me, because it's the Word of God and systematizing it, understanding it. And there, some of you are saying, "Well, Bob, okay, I agree with all that, basically, but it sounds like you're saying we have to obey the whole Mosaic law." And didn't Jesus, when we believe in Jesus, the law is our tutor to bring us to Christ. Now we have Christ, we're no longer under the tutor. And Paul says, "The law is good if you use it lawfully, knowing that the law is not made for a righteous man, for the unrighteous." And Bob, it sounds like you're saying we're under the law. Well, we don't have time to get into a theological discussion of this, which is too bad, because I would love to. It would be fascinating and phenomenal. But let me say this. The law has not changed. The moral criminal code has not changed from Adam, before Moses, before the law, right? Adam, well, murder was wrong. So Cain killed Abel. That was wrong. with Moses, do not murder. It was wrong. Today, even for a Christian, it's wrong. You don't murder. And the governing officials, the judges, they're not supposed to judge your heart. Just because you're a Christian doesn't mean you can steal because God will forgive you. The judge judges your earthly actions, and God will judge the heart. So the governing officials need to apply the law to believers and to unbelievers. Now, what part of the law? Well, Adam, did he circumcise? No, he didn't circumcise. God gave that as a covenant to Abraham. And if we read back in Genesis, where God gave the covenant of circumcision to Abraham, God said, this is a symbol. This is a sign of my covenant with you, Israel. So what part of the Mosaic law should the government enforce? Should it enforce the symbolism? Like you should eat clean animals and not unclean animals. That was symbolic. That was a symbolic teaching. God saying, I want my nation to be dedicated to me, holy and separate, and I want to separate you from the unclean nations. So I'm going to give you special clothing where they couldn't mix wool and linen, and a special diet. And you are going to circumcise, symbolic differences between God's people who are willing to obey him and the world who will not. So no, the government should not enforce, should not attempt to enforce. It would be foolish, ludicrous, and ungodly for the government to try to enforce the symbolic teachings in the Mosaic law. But the moral criminal code is exactly what the government should enforce. And as Christians, if we break the moral criminal code, like if we murder or commit adultery, Paul says, I may not be under the law, but I don't want to do that which is not expedient. All things to me are lawful, he says. All things are lawful. He says, for I'm under grace and not under law, but I will not do that which is not expedient. So it's a teacher. We know that murder is wrong, and stealing is wrong, and adultery is wrong. Finally, I'd like to reinforce one point, that you cannot ignore God and proceed with no result, no ramification, no consequence. You can't do that. God's word will not return to him void. So when you speak a word to someone, tell them about the gospel. Either they're going to get saved, or on judgment day, that will be used against them. God's word will not return void. It has an effect. It does its job one way or another. It cuts like a two-edged sword. So we are going to have the death penalty. Either we'll have it the way God said we should have it, and we will swiftly put to death murderers and kidnappers and perjurers in a capital trial. We'll swiftly put them to death, and we'll have the death penalty executed justly by the governing authorities in very small numbers, an incredibly few number of executions per year. Or if we dismiss God's way as foolishness, then all we do is shift and multiply the death penalty, and we will have thousands upon thousands of innocent people being put to death in the lives of murderers who would not have been murderers had there been enough Christians and enough godly people in the country to insist that we do things God's way. You see, we save the murder victims, and we have the chance of saving the murderers themselves, because they wouldn't have become murderers in the first place. So it's the one way or the other way. We can't have both. And if we ignore God's way, we will have the death penalty spread out like an epidemic, which is what we have. And the greatest disaster that comes to us from rejecting the death penalty is the result in men's lives and their souls and their eternal salvation. Because God said in Hebrews, we know that if a man dies without mercy because he's a murderer, he's a criminal, then how much worse a punishment will you get if you ignore Jesus Christ's death? Wow, that is a powerful, persuasive argument for the lost. But today, we are allowing the masses to mock God and mock his justice, because even Christians mock God's word. God will exalt the law and make it honorable. And we Christians need to get on his bandwagon because God knows where he's headed. He hasn't just concocted this as a crazy scheme. God's wisdom is tremendous, and it's here in the Bible. And I implore you to stand with me in support of the Lord. Don't be ashamed or embarrassed of not one word of what God says, because he is right. And you and I together, let's pray and ask God to help us to do right and risk the consequences.
There's a blue streak, like a paintbrush stroke through my heart. It's a cool light, and it tears the darkness apart. I can hear it, when I listen close, I can hear it. Like a needle, the word sews into my spirit. There's a rumble, like a 3-day hunger or thirst. Deep inside me, and I think that maybe I'll burst. Like a freight train, on a one-way track through the canyon. Paying no mind to the walls of worldly opinion. Little lambs to stutter.